1, ignition.
The clock is ticking. All systems are a go. These filmmakers are now focused on assembling this jumble of celluloid into a finished film. However, in order to realistically simulate the true feeling of flight, these filmmakers have to resort to some rather unconventional methods in creating their visual effects. Through obstacles and challenges, trial and error, decisions made at this stage will continue to resonate over the next 20 years and beyond.
Major challenge on this picture was doing the special effects. This was before computers were even known. No one had heard of CGI at that point. And how we were going to manage to get the shots that we needed was almost conjecture. Phil, who was living in San Francisco, knew of Gary Gutierrez.
I think that Phil saw in me and my sort of fledgling company, I think he sort of identified with us as young filmmakers who weren't necessarily predisposed to specific classical ways of doing things. I guess in every project there's a sort of an evolution you go through, and you have your theories to begin with, and then you have your experiments that you do that prove most of those theories wrong.
The early stuff that they started to do was all this motion control stuff, and it was very, very pristine and perfect and everything.
I was just so unhappy with the, you know, the kind of look and feel of that. My feeling was it works on outer space, on other planets, but it doesn't work well on this Earth.
The thing that Phil really wanted to do was really create a visceral sense of what it was like.
And it sort of came to a crux at some point when Phil asked me to come down to his location in the Mojave Desert.
And I said, look, we've got to really start all over with the effects.
He managed to express his displeasure with sort of the way things were going, but also to give me enough encouragement to suggest that I should trust my own instincts and be willing to try some crazy things and see what I could come up with.
We basically, you know, went and got together with Gary, and we started doing things with the visual effects that basically amounted to, you know, throwing model airplanes off of buildings.
It was sort of like 19th century science. It was like if we could make it out of surgical tubing and wire and do stuff with helium balloons, we could sort of do anything. There's a beautiful shot where the F-104 is supposed to be flying straight up, we attached helium balloon, attached a 30, 40 foot wire tether to it, and at the bottom of that was the F-104 model attached to that. So we just released the balloon, and it would take the plane up with it on this long wire trailing below, and we just framed the balloon out. So all you could see was this plane going straight up in the air, and it would twist a little bit and catch a nice glint of light, and you see that shot in the movie.
And then combining that with the works of Jordan Belson, who was one of the 60s icons of experimental film, who created a lot of the outer space effects, you know, the heavens sort of opening up, or, you know, the fireflies around John Glenn.
I see something strange out here. Oh, my goodness gracious, what the heck is that?
Sparks, needles of some kind all over the sky.
All the images that are there are really unique and full of impact, and I was just sort of in awe of the effects he was creating, and I have no idea how he created them. We pumped him for information, but he wouldn't give.
We had about 120 people doing special effects, creating sort of elaborate sound effects, and editing all the documentary footage and so forth.
I think the first time I really caught on to what was happening was going into one of the editor's rooms where he was cutting up some of our footage. And when you see the flying sequences and the right stuff, you see that screen direction is thrown out the window. That was all edited with for a kind of kinetic energy. Seeing that footage was quite a rush, and I think it energized all of us when we started to see what it was going to look like.
We knew we had a good film, but we also knew we had a very long film. At one point, it was 5 hours long. So we went through that process of cutting it down.
The editing just took a long time.
And now the post-production period was getting squeezed, and we had to find a composer real quick. And we decided on Bill Conti.
Well, normally, you know, you arrive and you do view. In most cases, you view a rough cut. But I think I was viewing a fine cut, which is the last cut, because they were really late.
No sweat, let's go. I'm ready when you are, John.
Instead of one of those procedures that take you from the script through musings about what the score could be, what would you like to do, try this, try that, it was really, let's do this now and get it over with. So I did.
Bill then wrote this great, great score, which I think, you know, is right up there with, you know, Dvorak's New World Symphony. I mean, it's just that kind of groundbreaking score, and he won an Academy Award for Best Score for it.
Company, who were great supporters of the film, had gotten an opportunity to do a premiere of the film in Washington, D.C.
It was the best premiere I think I have ever been to in my entire life. We went to Washington, D.C. They showed it, screened it in the Kennedy Center.
A lot of dignitaries, red carpet, cross sabers.
Lots of people seemed to think that this was an amazing start for the film.
But it was not a success. It was just supposed to be the biggest success, if, you know, there ever was. And it was the same year that John Glenn was running for president.
They had a big picture, I remember that picture cover of me on Newsweek, Can a Movie Make a President? You know, which sent a weird signal. It was like, what is this film about? Is this like some, you know, pro-John Glenn campaign movie or something? It had nothing to do with it.
Which one's Glenn? He's the one I want to meet.
As I recall, Irwin and Bob of the studio had a poll taken in which they approached people in line to The Big Chill, which was another film out at that time, and say, why is it you're going to The Big Chill instead of The Right Stuff? And the invariable answer was, oh, we're going to go see The Right Stuff, because we know how important it is for understanding this election, but tonight we just want to kick back and have a... and have a good time. So, I mean, it turned out to be a real albatross, this connection with civics and current politics.
I really wanted a wider release. I've forgotten exactly how many theaters it was released in. My sense is that it was about 7 theaters. It was done with a kind of, the idea was roadshow. I don't think we went wide for at least 3 months. Or more, maybe. It wasn't until after the first of the year. And by then, the fate had been decided.
But the film has become a classic. It's stayed around, it's stayed around, and people still refer to it.
And I think it speaks to a generation that that wasn't around.
People remember this film. It's stayed with them.
It's great, because in the years since, I mean, it certainly stood the test of time. It's a major American film. It's been around for 20 years. It'll be around for another 20 at least. It's got resonance, you know. I mean, it's well made. People will still check it out.
It is now looked upon as one of the, you know, wonderful films of the 80s.
It is my pleasure to introduce to you 7 Americans, gentlemen all, Americans, Mercury.
Every day was exciting. Every day was a new challenge, and we met them. And it felt great to be part of it.
It was a really fun film to work on from the point of view of, you know, the subject matter, but Phil also made it fun because he was a big believer in the story and in the whole idea of the film.
You know, to be part of an iconic movie that has got a lot of soul and substance to it, you don't get those chances very often.
I mean, the movie was both on screen and off a great adventure.
When I think about the experience, I think about the relationships and the trust that was shared amongst us all.
It was just, it was a real sense of community unlike anything I've ever experienced on a movie set. It was a 9-month shoot, and no one wanted it to be over. It was such a labor of love.
Now, this film may not have done well its first go-round, but like the people and the period of time it represents, The Right Stuff has been flying high for 20 years now. And one could expect it will continue to be enjoyed and admired for all its glory and spectacle for years to come.